When Disneyland opened in 1955, Tomorrowland was perhaps the least complete land of the park, featuring rides that were still being finished just days before opening. Soon after the 1964 World's Fair, Disney opted to open a successor of the Ford Magic Skyway in the form of the Wedway PeopleMover, an extremely high-capacity, grand circle tour experience around the whole of Tomorrowland. Welcome to Amusement Labs, where today I'll show you the history, engineering, and technological ingenuity used to bring the PeopleMover to life in 1967. This video is sponsored by generous patrons, especially Levi Valentine, Felix Monteza, and Brandon Wiggins at patreon.com/amusementlabs. Starting in the early 1960s, the Walt Disney Company, under the direction of Walt Disney himself, partnered with the Ford Motor Company on a sponsored attraction designed to advertise and demonstrate their new vehicle designs. Rather than fabricate a simple elevated roadway and hiring hundreds of drivers to drive the cars through the attraction, the Walt Disney Company devised a ride system that which speed and steering could be controlled. This new system later debuted in the 1964 World's Fair as the Ford Magic Skyway, letting passengers sit in any seat, including the driver's seat, on a peaceful journey around the fair and a 273,000 square foot show building. In order to achieve the track driverless system, the entire engine of the vehicles was removed and the steering wheel was disabled. Instead, a steering wheel assembly hidden below the roadbed was connected to the rear of the vehicle via a rod through the slot in the road, with another assembly in the front that actually steered the wheels and the vehicle. In order to propel the vehicles, hundreds of drive tire motors rotating at a constant rate were dotted along the entire path. These drive tires contacted a grip plate on the underside of the vehicle to move them along. As you can see, this early version of the ride system would later branch into something much more advanced and ready for being installed in a park. Up until 1966, the attractions within Disneyland's Tomorrowland were not much more than similar advertisement attractions or rides featuring heavy product placement seen at the 1964 World's Fair. In an effort to change the direction that Tomorrowland had taken over the years, the bulk of Tomorrowland was entirely redesigned and dubbed the New Tomorrowland, featuring many World's Fair attractions making their way to Disneyland. With the running theme of World on the Move, Disney sought to bring the much-needed kinetic energy into the entirety of Tomorrowland, and thus the PeopleMover was born. Officially opening on July 2, 1967 with the rest of New Tomorrowland, the original Disneyland PeopleMover consisted of a slender and modern-looking white elevated platform track that covered 3/4 of a mile in total. The course wound around and intertwined with various attractions, allowing each of the whopping 64 trains to take 16 guests each on a peaceful scenic Grand Circle tour of Tomorrowland. As mentioned, the track was mostly concealed within the sleek elevated platform, which held 2 flat rails that each vehicle traveled over. In order to roll and secure the vehicles to the rails, each car used 4 sets of steering wheel bogies that engaged with the track. These bogies pivoted on the end of a bar, which then center pivoted on each side of each car. Each car was connected to each other by a bar with 2 universal joints, on one on each end, and on the very bottom of the cars was a body-length grip plate. This grip plate would engage with hundreds of Goodyear drive tires dotted along the layout. Given the constant motion of the attraction, the station used a large ring or disc that rotated at the same rate the cars moved through the station. In the station, small ramps in the track would also actuate the doors and the top cover above open when entering and closing them just before leaving. This mechanical and spring-loaded actuation method can still be found on classic rides like the Haunted Mansion. Once each train of 4 cars left the station, it would traverse the curves and gentle grades of the layout over the tires. In areas where the vehicle accelerated from a different speed, it would pull off of the slower tires behind it thanks to the stronger patch of motors ahead. During uphill and downhill sections, As well as turns, the track would also have tires be closer together to allow for better traction on the bottom of the cars. Unfortunately, as one of the results of being a product of the 60s, the vehicles were entirely independent from each other and there was no master control system to space each of the vehicles. Other than careful spacing in the station and control of the tires thereafter, there was no way to keep the trains of cars from colliding, something that did happen rarely when bad traction meant moisture, causing the train to stall and another to catch up to it. In the later Tomorrowland Transit Authority PeopleMover at Disney World's Magic Kingdom, the layout was changed to be completely flat and use induction motors to magnetically propel the trains, giving the ride a more futuristic look. Aside from the tires and track rails, the platform track also contained three electrical connection bars that each car connected to in order to power various lights and something that was still rather new, zone-specific onboard audio. Because compact audio playback equipment was expensive and anything but compact, Disney decided to instead rip a page right from their World's Fair work, saving them time, money, and space in the cars. This growing technology was integrated after first testing on the Ford Magic Skyway, where guests could change the radio station and tune in to different zone-specific audio. This was achieved by embedding a low-range radio antenna wire within the track that broadcasted audio that was easily picked up by the radio in each Ford vehicle. What the PeopleMover brought was the ability for the cars in the train to change the station automatically via triggers in the track. Under one of the seats, a radio, along with speaker equipment, was stored and speakers were placed in the center of each car. Under the entire train was a receiver wire that picked up the transmission, but was also shielded against other transmission interference. When timed right, the triggers in the track would cause the cars to tune into the proper station right as the narration on a loop began. But if not, you would sometimes hear the narration start over if it was behind. This allowed for the radios to be within their own zone and be localized enough to broadcast clearly and easily. During long narrations, there were also different stations right next to each other, but staggered to be just right for each of the cars. The Wedway PeopleMover traversed through the highlighted attractions and took guests on their Grand Circle tour of Tomorrowland and above the Autopia Gardens just north. In 1995, the PeopleMover closed for good during a second revitalization effort and a push to make the ride into something more thrilling. When the new Rocket Rod took over the track above Tomorrowland in 1998, its queue took the place of the Circle Vision Theater, with PeopleMover cars painted over, lined with black light tape, and dumped in the queue. As for the ride, Rocket Rods brought a high-speed, lower-capacity thrill ride that ultimately failed to operate reliably and, as Disney maintenance later found out, safely. But that's a mechanical nightmare for another video. The Disneyland PeopleMover was a well-thought-out, reliable, and seamless experience that benefited from a simple design and clever mechanics to operate for decades. The engineering behind the ride alone is one of Disney's earliest crowning achievements, and even though it no longer operates, its influence can still be seen around the world as it lives on in the Tomorrowland Transit Authority PeopleMover and other attractions to this very day. And that's how the PeopleMover worked. If you like this video, please subscribe, and if you like what we do, consider joining our Patreon for early access to videos. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the parks.